You want to be seen by your market as the most trusted advisor for life, not just for a short static moment. You want to be seen as the only viable choice they could make in the category or in the issue, problem, area that you represent. And the way that you do it is by establishing positioning that, first of all, has to be truly believed by you, because it can't be inauthentic or you'll be found out. But it's all about leadership. You're leading me. And just so you know this, human beings, every one of us, you, me, Chris, Taylor, everyone in this room, people outside serving us, we all want to be led. We're silently begging to be led. However, we want to be led by somebody we feel absolutely has our best interest, not theirs, at heart. And the sooner and the easier you establish that distinction, the more powerful you are in their mind's eye. Simple, but I don't think anyone's ever really crystallized it like that for you. So it's all about being a leader to somebody who wants to follow, but they just want to trust that they're following somebody who's got their back. People don't trust everything else. They hear all the same rhetoric and they discount it. So you're basically, if you can do this, and this, we created this originally for the newsletter business, which were a bunch of contrarians and a bunch of counter thinkers. So it was very powerful. But if you start by saying, it doesn't have to be this blatant, but you're not being told the whole truth, or you're not being told the whole story, or you're not being told how either easy or how different it can be. And then here's the truth or the reality as I see it. It's very powerful. Most people don't know what focus is until they make it. So you have to help give people focus, because focus gives them clarity. Clarity gives them power, and power gives them the authority to be able to make a decision, like a yes, or here's my credit card, or yes, I want to be part of that $5,000 upgrade. Okay, I believe that your job is to invest in the other side first before money changes hands. And if you're driven with the belief system that it's only a matter of time before the people you want to deal with will be doing compensated business with you, and you're not going to wait for that time to add incredible value, but you are clear about it. I have a differing belief system than most people who give free stuff. I think it is very important to establish almost an implicit or an explicit contractual relationship with the other side when you are going to invest in valuable education or IP or instruction. And when people just say, hey, get this free for an opt-in, I think that's okay, but I prefer establishing that, hey, I want to invest in you, or I want to buy you $500, $1,000, $50 worth of knowledge. I want to share with you distinctions, ideas, strategies that have already made 10, 15 million or billion dollars. And I don't mind not asking to be paid, but I do expect two things. One, if you're going to access it, if you're going to avail yourself, take advantage, I expect you to do something with it. And I expect you to do something with it in a timely manner. And I expect you to judge me accordingly. And if it affirms what I am promising, I expect you to appreciate that there's a lot more behind that, and that you will seriously investigate and examine the other services that I offer. And if that's not a fair deal, don't do it. But that's how I operate. Because I think there's not a lot of connection anymore with the free stuff and the why you're doing it, and it's not a lot of value to it. And I think if we don't value ourselves, there's no way that you can ask the market to. That's just my opinion, but you might want to evaluate that. It's worked pretty well for my clients and I. It's very interesting. So, pardon me. If you want to be seen by your market as the ultimate viable choice, the, you know, the preeminent advisor that they can turn to. You got to start referencing them in the right context in your mind's eye. So a lot of people talk about a customer. And if you look up the definition of a customer in Webster's Dictionary, it's somebody who buys a commodity or a service. So if you refer to the people you sell to as customers, in the purest psychological sense, what you are saying to yourself is that you're nothing more than a commodity. If you look up the definition of a client in Webster's, it's somebody who's under the care, the protection, the well-being of another. It has more of a fiduciary context, which is what I think you want the role you serve or your company serves to them to be. Does that make sense? Yeah. So it's a little self-talk. And you want to know who you're communicating with. What problems are you going to help them deal with today and every time you interact? And it's very important. I see a lot of communication that people send out being neutral. It doesn't really advance and enhance the relationship. You should look at every time you interact with anybody in any way, whether it be online, offline, video, audio, whatever the vehicle, whatever the purpose, it's got to leave them better off each time. They've got to feel intuitively or implicitly or explicitly that, hey, I'm better because of what I just heard, read, said. And if you're not, then you're either adding or you are taking, because nothing is really static, is it? So, I mean, if you look at quantum physics, you're either expanding or you're contracting. And that's sort of the communication you're having with your market. And I'm being a little too sophisticated here. Does this all make sense?
Yeah.
It's cool stuff and it works. And I'm giving you a different set of perspectives than Chris and Taylor. And as I said, I used to do a lot of tactics. I don't really much anymore. I can, but it's not where my highest and best use is. So you want to ask, how are we going to have the most positive impact immediately today? And that gold client, oh, you don't see it even. I'm looking at it. Yeah, is that, yeah, okay. I don't know if I have the same ones or not. If they're not, I apologize. And the message you're communicating doesn't have any value unless it makes an impact and gets them to take an action. An action doesn't have to be necessarily going through the response, although the call to action is what you're wanting. But another action, which is a little more subtle, is stopping them from the maddening crowd and doing what Tony would call a pattern interrupt, where you get them to really think deeply. We've got a bunch of things we created when I was more prolific. One of them is a document called How Does Your Business Really Stack Up? It's part of a 200. We ask, when I'm looking at a client, we ask them to answer 200 question assessment that they can't answer. And we do it not because I need the knowledge, although I look at it, but because they need to understand the gaps. And we want them to question themselves about things that are very self-evident the moment they are expressed, but that they've never thought about. So part of a call to action, I would suggest to you, is not just getting them to, you know, you want them to ultimately buy, but you want them to stop before they buy and think, don't you? You want them to think differently about you vis-a-vis everybody else, because statistically, and not necessarily, you might have found a virginal niche, but unless you have, you're competing in media where you're not the only person or company going after them for the same thing, are you? Probably not. So you want to stop them from thinking the same way about everything, so they will take the transactional action. Does that make sense?
Yes.
I'm much more into the strategy behind things. I mean, the specifics of how you execute it is very different. It's not one size fits all.